This program is a Warren Stiebel production in association with South Carolina ETV. Funding for Firing Line is made possible by a major grant from the John M. Olin Foundation, Incorporated, and the Friends of Firing Line.
John Kenneth Galbraith has just now published his 31st book. He began it as a biographical sketches of mighty men and women he has known, but was taunted by an associate who, hearing of it, said it sounded like a lot of name-dropping to him. Professor Galbraith thereupon changed the working title of his book, and it's now called Name-Dropping. A neat job of disarming his critics. What we have
is... No, I didn't disarm them, Bill. I said that nothing so disables a prosecutor as a prior confession of guilt.
I'm disabled. What we have is personal portraits and appraisals of Franklin Roosevelt, Eleanor Roosevelt, Albert Speer, Harry Truman, Adlai Stevenson, John F. Kennedy and Jackie, Nehru, Lyndon Johnson, with sketches added of lesser prominences. Galbraith is mostly celebrated for his massive books of economic disorientation, but is admired by all sides for his lucidity and wit as a writer. In this book, he penetrates his subjects with characteristic skill and with no diminution of the opinionated mordancy which is his stamp. I note that the book is a mere 190 pages, which is sufficient to convey Mr. Galbraith's art and his views. We will depart a bit from the normal composition of Firing Line in that I propose not to argue with Mr. Galbraith, having been disabled, but to hear him tell you some of his stories. I choose, for subjective reasons, to ask about Adlai Stevenson. Mr. Galbraith was busy during the campaign of 1952 writing some of the candidates' speeches. In this book, he reflects on his shortcomings as a presidential speechwriter in that campaign. What were those shortcomings?
That's so typical, Bill. Here's a group of people for whom I have the greatest admiration. And characteristically, you add inquirers to the shortcomings. It's nice to be back in normal circumstances with you again. But the problem I didn't realize at the time, Adlai Stevenson was a wonderfully companionable person. He was always glad to see you. You always had a nice time with him. And he had an intelligent range of interests. But those of us who worked with him had the fatal tendency of writing speeches for him rather than for the public at large. And we wrote speeches where we admired our own work, but we were unfortunately less admired by the American public. And so those of us who were on his staff, and I wrote a lot of the speeches when his 1952 speeches were published as a book, and I put them in with my other books. For a good share of them, I was one way or another responsible. There were other speechwriters too, I hasten to say. But the problem was that we were writing for him, and we were writing for a relatively small American community, and not for the public at large. And Adlai was very much averse to anything that might be called rabble-rousing, anything which had a wider public appeal.
Was there a sharp distinction between his voice to the public and FDR's?
Very much, yes. FDR could identify himself much better with the American public as a whole than could Adlai Stevenson. He was also much more susceptible to suggestion, recommendation. The great charm of FDR, as I tell in the book, was that he had no fixed ideology, unlike you, Bill. And
what causes my charm?
And therefore, he was open and seemed to be open to recommendations from a wide circle of people. And to a certain extent, he was. So you could, with FDR, a large number of people felt that they were part of the scene and part of the administration. And in contrast with Stevenson, there was a much more elect group. And that was something that we didn't fully recognize at the time.
Well, when you went to work for Jack Kennedy, had you by then realized the mistake you had made in 1952?
No, I'm not sure that I realized it, but Kennedy certainly did. Kennedy had criticized Adlai Stevenson, not explicitly, but that was the uneasiness, was that his appeal was to a smaller elite group, and the Kennedys were of the masses. There was something in background there. Adlai Stevenson was from a small privileged community, and Kennedy was from the great Irish proletariat, one step away.
So Kennedy directly decided on the tone of his rhetoric, and or was it that his assistants caught on to his natural style?
I think his assistants got on to that. I think to some extent we came to understand it. But this was Kennedy's initiative, no question about that. And Kennedy also always had a certain uneasiness about Harvard professors as to whether they were sufficiently identified with the public at large. He excused me to some extent because I was a farm boy, had come from rural Canada, and had some of the same official background as one who had come from Ireland. But
he discovered you were a man of the people.
Beg your pardon?
He discovered that you were a man of the people.
He was willing to accept me as a man of the people, but he had a certain uneasiness even where I was concerned. I once, could I tell a story?
Of course.
I once, I acted as liaison during the campaign between Mrs. Roosevelt, between Eleanor Roosevelt and Kennedy. And what I thought was one of my great achievements was getting Kennedy to go on Mrs. Roosevelt's television program. You understand what a television program can be, don't you? And she was up at Brandeis University and agreed to it, despite the fact that there was a great deal of friction between the Roosevelts and the Kennedys going back to JFK's father. But the program went very well. They had a good discussion, and I listened to it with admiration and a good deal of self-appreciation. And then inevitably, afterward, there was a press conference and a big turnout of the press. And the first question was, now, Mrs. Roosevelt, does this, your appearing on this program with Senator Kennedy, mean that you will support him in the election? She said, it certainly does not. And of course, that was what got all the news. And that night, I had dinner with Kennedy. We often had dinner on a Saturday night when he was up in Boston. And he leaned back in his chair and he said, you know, I once thought there was some chance that a Harvard professor would know something about politics and not be damaging, but I'll never believe it again after tonight.
Was there, in fact, a reconciliation?
It was a slight overstatement on his part.
No, did Mrs. Roosevelt end up backing Adlai?
By summer, this all took place on the 1st of January of 1960. And by that summer, she had come around to be quite a strong supporter of him. And
were you responsible for that?
Well, I certainly urged it and urged her to believe that he was a good president, which, as you will, of course, agree, he was.
Well, when you went to India as ambassador, did you maintain your close connections with Kennedy?
Oh, sure. The Harvard Press, a year or so ago, published a quite substantial and, of course, highly readable book of my letters to Kennedy during that time. And the State Department protested strongly that my immediate communication with the president, they wanted my letters to come through
the censors.
State Department.
Yeah.
And that produced one of the exchanges of my life. Kennedy sent me a letter, a telegram asking whether I approved of this recommendation that all my communications come through the State Department, and asked what I thought of it. And I sent back a telegram marked secret, which meant that it would have wide distribution, this is, I hope, appropriate, saying that communicating through the State Department was like making love through the mattress.
Well, how was the
I might have used a somewhat more evil word, but I want to.
How was the reorientation from Kennedy to LBJ? Was that difficult to effect?
Well, Lyndon Johnson and I were the same age, 3 months apart, and we had been friends since the 1940s, when he was a young congressman. So I was very much a part of that transition period, and saw a lot of LBJ during that time. And then what was in some ways the saddest feature of my marginal political life, I was very much opposed to the Vietnam War, and he got caught up in that evil circumstance. And I eventually realized that there was nothing that I was doing persuading, so I went public, backed Eugene McCarthy, and as I say in the book, I never saw Lyndon Johnson again. He was an extraordinarily able person, and a wonderful political figure. And when he wanted you to do something, you were never in doubt as to whether you had to do it or not. He took you by the shoulders and forced you into it.
As you think back on it, how is it that Mac George Bundy, a distinguished Harvard figure, stayed with him on the Vietnam front?
Well, there was a split in the academic community. Mac George Bundy was his advisor on foreign policy, a wonderful man to whom I'm greatly indebted because we had a very close association at Harvard. He as dean, I as a professor. But he was more committed to the Vietnam War and to a military solution than I was. And while we remained friends, we parted on that issue. We remained friends for the rest of his life, and I shared the sorrow a year or so ago when Mac died.
Departing from the domestic scene, Mr. Galbraith, tell us, this is apropos Kosovo, about your commission right at the end of the war that President Truman gave you to investigate the damage in Germany.
Well, that was actually given to me by FDR, who all the news that came from Germany and Japan, but particularly from Germany, as to the effect of the air attacks, came from the Air Force, from the Air Generals. And Roosevelt, before his death, decided that there should be, as the war wound to an end, a full investigation of what had happened. And I was director of what was called the Overall Effects Division. There was a talented group of people, including George Ball, Paul Nitze, others. But I had a very good staff of statisticians. And the German records, of course, were very complete. And we concluded, on the whole, that the air attacks had not appreciably shortened the war. That was one on the ground. And that the air attacks, moreover, had, this was not so clear, but almost self-evident, that the bombers were more feared than the German government. If you have a choice between a bad government and an American bomber overhead, you will prefer the government. And that, I see, is one of the lessons of Kosovo. The air attacks did not work effectively in Germany. They were a nearly complete failure in Vietnam. Even before that, they didn't rescue General MacArthur in Korea. That was decided also on the ground. And they haven't been notably successful against Saddam Hussein. Well, so I've had, one more word and this lecture will be over. So I've had, said that at the outset of the bombing in Kosovo, that it would be a disappointment, and I think it's fair to say that it has been.
You didn't mention in your chapter on Albert Speer that in his own autobiography, he said that a couple of weeks more of that kind of bombing would have put Germany out of commission. Is it because you didn't? Well, tell us about your meeting with Speer.
At the end of the war, with George Ball and Paul Nitze, we interrogated Speer for several days. And he provided us with all the figures.
Remind us who he was.
Pardon?
Remind us who he was.
He was Hitler's architect, who was put in charge of the war production effort in Germany. And I have to quarrel with you, Bill. I don't think he ever said that, because he made clear at that time that the air attacks had not appreciably limited production. There were some spectacular things. In February of 1944, we attacked the aircraft industry in Germany. The intelligence was good. Every aircraft plant was hit, I think almost every one. And in March, production was up 30%. They organized a great group of people, cleared off the rubble, organized new assembly lines, some of them running through neighborhood schools and churches, and presently had production back and even higher. There was also a change of administration from Goering to Speer, which was a big advantage. And this was, these figures became available to us as the war ended from the data that Speer had when we interrogated him at Flensburg.
The, I had personal views of the speed with which the Vietnamese rebuilt their bridges, but even so, it seems to me that one has to pay some attention, even if one remains skeptical, to claims by military people that there is such thing as the incremental bomb, non-nuclear bomb. we are told that the day will come when the military machinery in Kosovo will simply be without oil, so to speak. Why should you insist that that's inconceivable?
Well, because the terrible truth, Bill, is that air power is a very imprecise instrument, and getting.
As the Chinese have discovered,
yeah. Beg your pardon?
As the Chinese have discovered.
As the Chinese have discovered. And it doesn't have the precision, for example, to stop the, probably doesn't, I don't know for sure, to stop, for example, the oil supplies to whatever need the Serb military has. We have, let me develop the point just a bit further. We have in the United States a desire for a kind of war where you don't go through the unhygienic, dangerous process of ground warfare, where you can sit somewhere away in hygienic circumstances and suffer small casualties. And that is the faith that lies behind our faith, our attitude toward air power. It's an article of hope rather than a reality.
But having made the commitment, is it in your judgment impossible to retreat from it while still maintaining the prestige that we ought to have as a superpower?
I would move quickly to any opportunity for negotiation, Bill, and I would stop the bombing and rely on time and patience rather than continue the risks, including the risks, of course, of larger conflict that are there involved.
How do you account for the British Labour Party being so enthusiastic about ground troops?
There are certainly differences of opinion available as between
Tony Blair
and his people and my particular attitude. And, you know, Bill, I accept that some people can be wrong.
Has it ever happened to you?
I don't readily concede it. That's a lesson I learned from you.
Well, tell me, Professor Galbraith, in reading this book about your high and mighty friends, which chapter has satisfied you most?
Oh, the one on FDR.
Yes.
Of my generation, there was no figure like Franklin D. Roosevelt. And I still wake up in the morning and say, well, Galbraith, you're still a New Dealer.
were you personally exposed to his charm, FDR's? You mentioned two meetings.
I had very few meetings with him.
Yeah.
I had, I suppose, one of the half dozen most influential, powerful jobs of the war. In the spring of 1941, before Pearl Harbor, I was put in charge of the price control program of the war, and held that until 1943, when my enemies substantially outnumbered my friends. It was not a popular, fixing other people's prices was not a guide to popularity.
Was that when you were telling them how many peas they should put in a can of pea soup?
That was not my idea. And so I started with a staff of seven. And the exact number I had when I finished was extended to those in rent control and rationing, but it was somewhere in the neighborhood of 17,000. The sort of thing, Bill, that you've always worried about bureaucracy, or public bureaucracy. And my life has been, I think it's fair to say, in terms of power, downhill ever since.
Thank you, Professor Galbraith, author of Name Dropping. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
This program was a Warren Steibel production in association with South Carolina ETV. Funding for Firing Line was made possible by a major grant from the John M. Olin Foundation, Incorporated, and the Friends of Firing Line. For information about a video cassette of this program, write to Firing Line, 2700 Cypress Street, Columbia, South Carolina, 29205. Or call 803-799-3449. That's Firing Line, 2700 Cypress Street, Columbia, South Carolina, 29205. Or call 803-799-3449.